So many battles waged over the years. And yet, none of them like this.
You'd be forgiven if, like a lot of people, you labeled director Matthew Vaughn's X-Men First Class a fluke. A one-off return to glory for the X-Men franchise before another cookie-cutter slog of a Wolverine movie came out. Here you had a fan-friendly director with only two cult successes under his belt, taking on the franchise's irate and doubtful fanbase. No one was too optimistic. It's never going to happen again, you may have scoffed. Fox is gonna foobar the whole thing like they usually do, you chortle. And Vaughn leaving the franchise after the sequel was announced probably didn't help expectations much. But here we are, the first truly great X-Men movie in a franchise that's the poster child for the term hit and miss. The first sign that this was going to be a hit was the return of Bryan Singer, the man who gave the franchise a strong two-movie hit start back in the days before the quality of such an endeavor was guaranteed, before anyone else dared make nerd culture products that took the material and fandom seriously. And let's be fair, they weren't great movies by today's standards, but they paved the way for the game changers that followed. So it feels right to have him back in the director's chair, enjoying the world he helped build, soaking up the applause and creative freedom that current nerd culture directors take for granted. So the movie starts in the dystopian future world template number 5. Shadowcat, Colossus, Iceman and a few new mutants make a glorious ill-fated last stand against a pack of sentinels in one of the best action sequences in a year inundated with amazing action sequences. Shadowcat uses her abilities to send the consciousness of Bishop back a few days to warn the group of the impending attack, thus preventing it from ever happening. The group then meets up with Professor X, and Shadowcat is tasked with sending the consciousness of Wolverine back to 1973 to change a crucial moment in history that would be the catalyst of the current war. Why Wolverine? I mean, besides his infinite marketability as a character. Because going back that far in time would destroy anyone else's mind. And Wolverine's healing powers somehow extend to his mental health as well. Genuine slow clap of admiration for the screenwriters for making the effort to legitimize shoehorning in Wolverine as the main character. Most of the movie from that point on deals with Logan back in 1973. Trying to get an alcoholic, powerless by choice Charles Xavier and imprisoned Magneto to reconcile long enough to change how the future unfolds. These are easily my favorite bits of the movie, as it shifts in tone from bleak and dystopian to comedic and lighthearted, with Logan and Beast exchanging quips and moments of genuinely funny slapstick. Long story short, they get the band back together, and after a somewhat labyrinthine sequence of plot points, change the future. Now let's talk about what this movie gets right. First up, perfect casting, but then again Singer already nailed that in the first movies. Secondly, pacing. The action and drama are so well paced that the shifting between past and future and all the various plot points and roster of new characters are easy to follow. Third, Pietro Maximoff, more commonly known as Quicksilver. Best new character ever. I won't say too much for fear of spoilers, but there's a Quicksilver sequence in the movie that left me crying with laughter. And finally, there's Singer himself, who seems to have perfected blending the various abilities of our heroes into the storytelling structure of the movie, using the visuals of various powers as a reason transition between scenes and shots and character perspective. It doesn't change a lot, but it really imbues the whole beautiful mess of a movie with a sense of cohesion that really brings it all together. The only real negative for me would be the studio's need to make Wolverine the central character in every X-Men movie. I, for one, am kind of bored of our immortal cigar-chewing Weapon X, and would like to see another character like Storm or Gambit take the mantle of the main character. In conclusion, I'd rate X-Men Days of Future Past a more than worthy follow-up to this year's current champion of superhero flicks, Winter Soldier. It balances action, drama, tragedy, suspense, complex plots in all the delicious ways we've come to expect from big-budget superhero movies. To be honest, it's the only Marvel franchise whose rights I hope won't revert back to Disney. It's just that good, and it might keep Disney on their toes.
Please. We need you to hope again.
Alright guys, thanks for joining us for another episode of Layan Filem. If you like what you see, leave a comment, like, and please subscribe for future episodes. Ciao.